if you look at the history of Gujarat, particularly from the late 90s, 1996-97, when the saffron RSS BJP first took control of the state, and you look at the growth of the corporate house Ambanis, the two have gone hand in hand. And this has not been investigated enough. This has not been interrogated enough, how these two entities, the RSS BJP political entity and the corporate entity of Ambani then and Adani today, actually have grown hand in hand. These are aspects that we need as political scientists, as activists, as interrogators of social systems to look at closely. The symptoms, of course, used to be pogroms, targeted violence. We saw this with the imagined campaign for a Ram temple at Ayodhya. We saw it with the acceptance of first a VHP resolution that was accepted by the BJP in 1986, which was never really for a temple in Ayodhya, but was actually for the complete perversion of Indian society and state. People's sentiments were aroused. A very creative and imaginative campaign was devised around the Ram temple. Ordinary people who really had no idea what they were supporting. Would you like to welcome her? Would you like to welcome her? Also got drawn into the campaign. But for many of us who have closely witnessed Advani's Rath Yatra, and I'm deliberately bringing this up at this juncture, because unless we look at the symptoms, we will not be able to tackle the disease. We saw his Rath Yatra begin. We saw his Rath Yatra begin from very close to Rajkot in Western Gujarat, from the Somnath Mandir. He was flanked by two people, Narendra Modi and Shankar Singh Vaghela at that time, when the Rath Yatra took off. I'm talking about 1989. And wherever the Rath Yatra went, wherever it went, it actually triggered blood and gore. There was hate speech. There was targeted violence. Whether you look at locations in India where, unfortunately, communal violence has happened before, but what the Rath Yatra did was, it went into those areas which had been untouched by communal violence and ensured that they became a permanent reality. So the campaign for the construction of the Ram Mandir was actually the campaign for the complete alteration of the Indian state and societal discourse. I believe that the government of 2014 could come with the majority it did, and the government of 2019 could also come with the majority it did because of the foundation laid in that period. Because even though we had a 10-year in between, a kind of a respite, some sort of a respite, there was reluctance to tackle the heart of the problem. There was a reluctance to get to the core of state prejudice. There was a reluctance to actually weed out the unconstitutionalism that had gotten hold of our institutions. I will not speak about the Supreme Court judgment on Ayodhya. It is there for everybody to see. But I will say that when we leave everything to the courts, when we leave matters of great social justice and importance for the courts to decide, and we know that our courts are hierarchized with lack of diversity, lack of democratization, then we get this kind of result. Friends, classical definitions of fascism, Germany and Italy have taught us some lessons. I hope we don't have to go through 21 years as Italy did. I hope we don't have to go through the horrors of the concentration camps that Germany did. But believe me, the effort is there. The effort is to make sure that we go through a minimum of 20, 25 years, if not more, of that kind of extremely violent, aggressive, and dictatorial rule. Fascism is not just autocracy and authoritarianism. It sort of gets symbolized in one leader. It's a far-right dispensation. And for the first time in India, though the neoliberal policies of earlier regimes have helped lay the foundations for what has happened afterwards, the difference is that for the first time, a far-right socio-political religious order is coming together with a far-right economic order. And hence today, I'm ashamed to say as an Indian that on the eve of International Human Rights Day, on the eve of International Human Rights Day, the Indian Parliament has today tabled a bill. And I would urge this esteemed assembly to pass a strong resolution against it. 900 scientists have opposed it. Even Shiv Sena today in its newspaper, Samna, has said that the BJP wants to divide and rule this country. Just now I was reading a party that in the past has used the language of illegal immigration to foment violence is today saying that this is going to divide people, going to cause poison in the polity, and it's a shame that the Modi regime is going ahead with the Citizenship Amendment Bill today. They tried to pass it in 2016. They tabled it again in 2019. It did not get passed. For the last one week, the Northeast is burning. Assam has had more than 45 protests across the state against cab, because Assam has a different history. Assam, there are different anxieties, right or wrong, about overtaking of the population and overtaking of the culture. But today's media, I'm sorry to say, television and print does not cover people's movements, does not cover people's protests. So we have to hunt around in the alternate media to find evidence and coverage of such protests. Friends, there are so many issues to talk about if we look at the last 6 years of lived proto-fascism. When I'm asked the question, are we already living in a fascist society? I take a step back and think, because if we were already living in a fascist society, maybe such meetings would not so easily take place. But the signs are there. This government, central government, is proto-fascist. It has no respect for the constitution. It wishes, in fact, to overthrow the constitutional principles of equality and non-discrimination. Because Kerala is always an oasis of sorts. Oasis, I hope, which will stay like an oasis in the years to come. I would like to concentrate my today's remarks before you on not just CAB, but the threatened NRC and NPR. Because it is something that people have not understood. And I think in the South, it is not being taken seriously. First, the Citizenship Amendment Bill. All of us know that ideologically, the Rashtriya Swayamsevak Sangh that controls this government has militaristic dreams of an Akhand Bharat. It talks of the unfinished agenda of India's partition. And therefore, I believe this amendment that is being proposed through the Citizenship Amendment Bill stems from that ideology. The amendment says that from three countries, Afghanistan, Pakistan, and Bangladesh, migrants who come in, if they can claim and convince the authorities that they have been persecuted minorities in those three states, and if these three minorities are from six communities, all except Muslims, then after a 6-year waiting period, they will be given citizenship. That is what the amendment says. The CPIM has moved amendments today. We don't know what is happening in Parliament. The Communist Party, the Congress Party, DMK, other parties have moved amendments to say that this must be expanded to all neighboring countries and must include all religious denominations and not exclude Muslims. In all likelihood, in Lok Sabha, there will be a steamrolling. One is to be hope. One hopes that in the Rajya Sabha, it will be rejected. Time will tell. What are the implications of this? First of all, the very thrust of this CAP 2019 is anti-constitutional. As we all know, as was stated by Iqbal sir in the beginning, this country, rooted in the freedom struggle, chose between 1947 and 1950, despite and in spite of partition, it chose composite nationhood. It chose equality, non-discrimination, and equality before the law as its foundational principles. So at the very base, this CAB amendment is violative of Article 13, 14, 15, 16, 17, 19, right up to 25 of the Constitution. We hope that it will not stand the test of scrutiny in the Supreme Court. Before we go that far, what does CAB do? CAB assumes, in the way that the RSS thinks, that the only people who would be coming as migrants from these three countries would be quote-unquote persecuted minorities. This flies in the face of migratory history because very often economic reasons and political reasons are as strong as religious reasons. Even if you look at religious persecution, it does not want to look at the Rohingyas of Myanmar. It doesn't want to look at the Ahmadiyyas of Pakistan. It doesn't want to look at the political dissenter of Pakistan who might want to come here. And it doesn't want to look at Sri Lanka. We have at least 1.5 to 2 lakh Sri Lankan refugees of different religious dimensions living in different parts of the country, particularly Tamil Nadu. But this government is not concerned about that. Because tomorrow is International Human Rights Day, I'd like to take the liberty of saying that 70 years down the line, it's very unfortunate that India has not formed an official refugee policy. And for this, we can't blame only the RSS and BJP. Previous governments are also to blame. We have not signed 2 international conventions on how countries should treat refugees. That is also an unfortunate history. We are, in that sense, friends, a young democracy. 70 years is a young time, and though we have Article 13, which behoves on Parliament to constitutionalize all our laws, please understand, Article 13 tells Parliament that any law made before 1950 should be constitutionalized. And yet, our police law, our criminal law, our sedition law, our Foreigners Act, and even our land acquisition law till 2013 was not repealed. So it took 70 years for people's movements to democratize even parliament and Indian democracy. Ambedkar said on 26th of November 1949, when he handed over the first draft of the Indian Constitution to the Constituent Assembly, he warned us that we are embarking on a very, very dangerous path. He said, we are giving ourselves political democracy and not really in a society which does not have social or economic democracy. And he has proved to be right. Increasingly, majoritarianism has crept into India's democracy. We have a first-past-the-post system. And today, various minorities, not just religious minorities, but the oppressed castes, the tribes, forest dwellers, Adivasis, they do not have genuine representation in this electoral system. So we need a lot of introspection. We need to think about proportional representation. We need to think about representatives in the sense that I believe we need to revisit Baba Saheb Ambedkar's communal award, which was brutally rejected at that time. Because today, out of a majority of the scheduled caste constituencies, it is the Bharatiya Janata Party that wins. And it wins because it chooses a Dalit candidate who is subservient to the Manusmriti ethos of the RSS. So even within the reserved constituencies, Dalits are not able to choose freely a representative that they want to be elected. So there are many challenges before us on the eve of International Human Rights Day. Constitutionalizing our laws, democratizing our institutions, our courts, our police systems, our textbooks. What kind of history do we teach? What kind of social studies do we teach? Which are the symbols that we revere? Is it a linear history? I mean, these are serious questions for introspection that we need to make and agitate for on the eve of International Human Rights Day. So many challenges that when I do a workshop with my Adivasi sisters and I tell them about the Constitution and the fifth schedule and the sixth schedule and the ninth schedule, and then I say that the Forest Rights Act is the recognition of rights law that you got in 2006. Their only question to me is, why did it take Parliament 56 years to give us that law? And that's the heart of the problem. 56 years it took for the Indian Parliament to enact a recognition of rights law. And even when it enacted that law, it did not repeal the 1927 Indian Forest Act, which the British had brought in only to stifle the Santal Adivasi agitations that were brewing in forest lands. And the brutal Forest Act of 1927 empowers the Van Vivag, the Forest Department, and gives them untold authoritarian power over the Adivasis and the forest dwelling people. So these are very, very crucial questions that we need to ask. However, what has happened to India in the last 6 years has put a brake on some of these questions. And why has it put a brake on some of these questions? Because even the small gains, that we made, slow and steady gains we made as a democracy between 1950 and 2014, leave aside the 2 years of the emergency and the years of the NDA government, 1992 to 2004, mostly you saw democratic steps slowly and surely taking place. However fleeting, however hesitant, you saw expressions of democratization taking place. What has happened after 2014, however, is that the government has declared a war on its own people. It's pretty much like what the British did. It's declared a war on all its people. So you have the Industrial Disputes Act and all the labor laws that have protected our workers, which came out of 150 years of bitter struggle, today being repealed. You have no proper agrarian policy and an assault on the Forest Rights Act. You have onion selling in the city of Bombay for 160 rupees a kilo, and the finance minister saying, "I don't eat onions." It's not even funny anymore. But the distance between those who govern and democratic forces has become very, very difficult to breach. So in these last 6 years, we have been compelled to go back to protect what little we had got or what lot we had got, along with preventing assaults of the future. So the challenge has become greater. My friend Uday Kumar himself is a survivor of this vindictive state. We ourselves have been survivors of a vindictive state. There are so many others whose names may not be as well known as ours, who are suffering because they dissent, they fight, they struggle. And therefore, today on the eve of International Human Rights Day, it's important to remember all of this and resolve how we can carry on. CAB, which is being tabled in the Lok Sabha today, which is likely to be passed by the Lok Sabha, but which hopefully will not be passed by the Rajya Sabha. The Citizenship Amendment Bill strikes at the very core of Indian nationhood, strikes at the very core of our constitutional principles and our ethos. It hits at right from Article 13 right up to 25. Insidiously brings in discriminatory citizenship. It relegates one lot of citizens, namely Muslims from three countries, to second-class status. And the messaging is very clear. The messaging is very clear that you want to create ferment in society. You want to create divisions in society. You want to not accept that India is a plural society, diverse society, and hopes to become an equal society. Friends, I have to now speak about the proposal of this government to bring in the NRC all over India. And to speak about that, one will need to visit Assam, where the NRC has created a humanitarian crisis of the most horrendous kind, which you cannot even begin to understand. As I mentioned before, our constitution that we gave ourselves on 26th of January 1950 is a foundational document. The Constituent Assembly debates that reflect the sentiment of a diverse set of voices before the Constitution was finalized. While the Constituent Assembly debates were taking place, this country went through the trauma of partition, right in the middle. And despite the fact that there was a trauma of partition, despite the fact that unfortunately there was a country being created on the basis of religion, our founding mothers and fathers, in their ultimate wisdom, due to their commitment to practicality and to pragmatism and to principle, says India will not go down that path. India will become a secular, socialist, democratic polity. And the preamble of our constitution, The preamble of our constitution that we are made to memorize in standard 6, we the people of India, I believe that is the pledge we need to take today at the end of this meeting. Equality of opportunity, justice, social, economic and political, fraternity, rationality, all of it is right there in our preamble. Article 5 to 11 of the Indian Constitution talks about citizenship. Who is an Indian? Does the law decide or does the Constitution decide? So Article 5 and 11 outline the basis of Indian citizenship. And Article 5 and 11 emphasize that in India, there will be different kinds of citizenship by birth, by registration, and by naturalization. What CAB is trying to do is change the parameters of the birth by naturalization by privileging one set of people and leaving out Muslims. Article 11 of the Constitution gives our parliament, gives Indian parliament the right to pass a law regarding citizenship. And this the parliament did in 1955. So we are governed, all of us are governed by the Indian Citizenship Law of 1955. What does this law tell us? In a nutshell, in brief, this law tells us that if you are born to this country before 1987, you are a citizen. If you are born after 1987, one of your parents has to have been born between 1950 and 1987. If you are born after 2004, then not only has one of your parents required to have been born before 1987, but the other parent should not have been an illegal immigrant. That is the legal position. For Assam, there's a difference. And I'll tell you why this difference. That's at the heart of the humanitarian crisis. For Assam, post the signing of the Assam Accord in 1985, an amendment was brought to the Citizenship Act, and Article 6A was inserted, which has created a certain separate, different category of citizenship or different kind of citizenship only for Assam, which I will explain in a minute. Let's go to Assam now. A border state, a state where, like many other parts of India, there was intense migration over the centuries. There's no part of India which has not seen internal migration for economic reasons, social reasons, all kinds of reasons. However, under British rule, the migration took on colonial motivations, because when the British wanted production to fill in their coffers, they took Tamil indentured labor to Sri Lanka, to the tea estates. And similarly, from Bengal, they took jute mill workers and tea estate workers to Assam. We are talking about the 19th century, 1826, 1856, 1876, over 200 years ago. Then, just like in other parts of the country, the divide and rule of the British in Assam took a peculiar character. There was a census commissioner in Assam called Mulan, notorious for his biased and partisan speeches. He talked of the Bengali bogey. He talked about how the Bengalis will take over Assamese culture, Assamese language, and there's a threat of the foreigner outsider in Assam. While saying this through the census officer, trying to create another division, they made Bengali the official language, ignoring Assamese. So they played this double game, as a result of which there was constantly a feeling in Assam that our culture and our language is going to be taken over by the outsider, read Bengali. All this carries on. We have partition. I'm sure many of you know it, but partition created huge migration. The census of 1951 tells us that 77 lakh people, that is 7,700,000 people, that is 7.7 million plus people, went from this side of the border to that side of the border. And 74 lakh people, that is 7.4 million people, came from there to this side of the border. It was the most humongous, numerically, in terms of numbers, the largest in the world instance of human migration. Just like Bengal, Bihar, Punjab, Delhi, Uttarakhand, Himachal, it also had its impact on Assam. And Assam, the impact, because of this background of this anti-outsider sentiment, took a particularly vicious form. And leading the two prime ministers in the 60s, Liaquat and Nehru, to sign a Pakistan Repatriation Scheme Pact, PIP Pact. I didn't know all this. I didn't know all this till my organization, Citizens for Justice and Peace, CJP, started working there for the last 4 years. We have 700 volunteers working in Assam, trying to alleviate the humanitarian crisis. And as we started working there, I had to sit down and understand this whole history, because otherwise you can't start working in a region. Under the PIP scheme, between the early 60s and 66, 2 lakh people were repatriated into Pakistan without even a trial. All this is part of our history. All this has happened on those tumultuous days, and it has left behind memories, questions, social schisms. Around 1975, a very violent movement is born in Assam. By 79, it takes a very aggressive form. It's known as the Assam movement. I remember I was in college at the time, and many of us who had lived through Maharashtra of 1965, when the Shiv Sena was born, many of us saw it as a very parochial movement. But the glamorous leaders of the movement became national heroes, Prafulla Mahanta included. ASU, Assam Gona Parishad, they became national figures at that time. And through that whole period, we saw at least 15 or 20 bouts of targeted communal violence where minorities, linguistic minorities, and religious minorities were targeted. It was on the back of this movement that India had its first genocidal massacre. People recognized Gujarat 2002, people recognized Delhi 1984, Thrissur knows about Bombay 92-93, but very few people know about Nelly 1983. February 18th, 1983, 2,500 poor Bengali-speaking Muslims were massacred within 6 hours in a region called Nelly in Assam. And another 700 were massacred nearby. So the death toll was over 3,000. Not just minorities. Left progressive forces who opposed this movement, who opposed AGP and ASU, many CPM activists, 61 people were slaughtered at that time, just like it happened in Punjab during the Khalistan movement. One particular story is gruesome. Krishak Mahamanch is the farmers organization, which is a mass organization of the CPM in Assam. Dhirendra Nath was the leader, president of a district. He was buried alive during this period. This is Assam's extremely violent history. It was on the back of this entire movement that Rajiv Gandhi government, state government, ASU and AGP, they signed the Assam Accord in 1985. And as per the Assam Accord, certain exceptions are made on the citizenship issue for Assam. What are those exceptions? The cutoff date will be 1971 because of the Bangladesh War. We had the Bangladesh War in December 1971. So the cutoff date is 23rd of March 1971, whenever a future list is made. But the Assam Accord also says that anybody who has been born in Assam and who can prove their voting rights before 1966, that means if they've been on the voting rolls, electoral rolls, will be citizens. Anybody who is there between 66 and 71 will be denied voting rights for 10 years, but after 10 years will be included as a voter. Assam Accord says one more thing, that the state of Assam will begin the exercise of creating a list of how many people are genuinely Indians, genuinely Assamese, and how many of people are infiltrators. In 2016 and 17, my organization started working in Assam. And I sat with all the progressive democratic leaders there and I asked, how did you even accept something like this? How can you ever accept a document or a set of documents deciding my existence as a citizen? It is legally untenable and it is practically completely impossible. When we sat with groups of linguistic and religious minorities, we realized that they had been completely fed up and targeted for 30 years over this label of being called foreigner. So they saw this as a constructive compromise. They said, ek baar ke liye ye baat khatam ho jayegi, ek baar list ban jayega. Maybe maximum 4 to 5 lakh will be identified. They'll be given some cards or whatever, and then the rest of us can live in peace. And therefore, in 2013, modalities were agreed to for the NRC. Supreme Court starts beginning to monitor the exercise. What are the modalities? You need these 14 documents to, one of these 214 documents, if you have, it's fine. If one of these 14 documents you do not have, then you have to have another set of 5 documents to prove your linkage to your father or mother who has those one of those 14 documents. For the last 6.5 years, the state of Assam has been reeling under the burden of just the NRC. The state has spent 1700 crores. Individual families, December 2017, 1.2 crore, meaning 120 lakh, 120,000 people were kept out of the list in December 2017. By July 2018, the figure had come to 4.4 million, 44 lakh. And by August 2019, it has come to 19 lakhs. All these families, 3 times over, they've had to go through the exercise. They have spent anywhere from 30,000 minimum to 5 lakhs per family. They have sold their small lands, their little jewelry, whatever they had. Assam is impoverished today. The government has been doing nothing but the NRC. No humanitarian work, no development work, no industry, no growth. Its GDP has gone down. And now the government wants to bring an NRC for the all of India. We are asking the government some very crucial questions. And I'll come to those questions. But before I come to those questions, I'd like to tell you a few stories about Assam. It's not just the NRC that has created the problem. I mentioned the PIP scheme. In 1997, there was an election commissioner of India who was hailed by India's middle class. Can you guess his name? T.N. Seshan. He started this exercise of declaring people D-voters, just doubtful voters, without examination of documents, without scrutiny of previous electoral rolls, without checking, has this family or this individual voted 10 times before? 2 lakh people in Assam were struck off the electoral rolls. All of them were Muslims. All of them were Muslims. What happens when you're struck off the electoral roll? The Assam Border Police sends you a notice. The law says that they are supposed to do an investigation first. They don't do it. It's a completely one-page notice with no reasons, nothing. And once you receive that notice saying you're a suspected foreigner, that family falls apart. Because then you have to go to the foreigner's tribunal. The foreigner tribunal is not like even a court. Not that our courts are very good, but at least they have certain procedures. All this is happening under a pre-50 law, the Foreigners Act of 1946. All of this is happening under executive order. It's not gone through parliament. It's not a statutory institution. Indian parliament has not debated on the Foreigners Act. Indian parliament has not discussed whether this foreigner tribunal meets the requirement under Article 323A or 323B, where tribunals are set up in India, which is the Green Tribunal, Income Tax Tribunal, Central Administrative Tribunal, etc. No. These are completely opaque bodies where your family can't enter with you. You have to go with your lawyer. Closed door. Media can't enter. And the record of these foreigners' tribunals is frightening. Bias, ex-party orders, lack of evidentiary procedure, and large numbers of people are simply declared foreigners. What happens then? Detention camps. I've requested my friends that we made a small film on detention camps. I hope we can show it to you today. My colleagues have shot it in Assam. It's a frightening story. It's worse than our jails. It's worse than even the colonial jails. Today, there are 2,000 people inside Assam's detention camps. 28 people have died inside Assam's detention camps. 20 people in Bengal have died either through suicide or heart attack, expecting an NRC to come in Bengal. Because when the 31st August 2019 list of the NRC came out, suddenly we realized that it's not just Muslims who are going to become the target. Out of the 19 lakh, yes, there were 5.2 lakh Muslims, but there were 8 lakh Bengali Hindus who are living there after partition. Point I'm trying to make, friends, is moment you give the government a power which is unlawful and anti-constitutional, you will find that the power of the document will decide your existence. And therefore, everywhere we are going, we are appealing to you. Please stand up, not just against CAB, but stand up against NRC as well. And that is why I requested that this booklet which we brought out should be picked up by everybody to understand the implications of what has happened in Assam and what will happen to the rest of the country if NRC is implemented. Friends, fifth president of India, Fakhruddin Ali Ahmad, entire family is out of NRC. Entire family of the fifth president of India out of NRC. Deputy Speaker of the Assam Assembly, family out of the NRC. JNU professor with an Assamese name, with a Bengali Hindu name, out of NRC. Mohammad Sanaullah, a Kargil war veteran, who fought in the Kargil war, is sent to a detention camp. He's there for 6 months before the Guwahati High Court releases him on bail. The question we are asking is, does the Indian Army employ people who are not Indians? What are you trying to do? What are you trying to suggest? UNICEF figures tell us that 58% of Indians only have birth certificates. Not all Indians have passports and LIC documents. That's a privilege of the middle and upper middle class. How many people have homes in their own names? How many people have land holdings in their own names? And yet, the Home Minister has taken out a circular to say that the NPR will begin from 1st of April 2020. What is the NPR? Friends, in 2003, when the NDA one government was there, Vajpayee's government, there were amendments brought to the citizenship rules, not to the act. It did not go through parliament. And in the citizenship rules, it was mentioned that the government will undertake the collecting data for a national population register, NPR. How will this happen? In Assam, people had to stand in queues at the Nagrik Seva Kendras. But according to the government, now this person, this set of officers will come to your homes to register the NPR. Then, after 3 months, at the district magistrate's office, you'll have to go and check. A list will be put up, and you'll have to see whether your name is in the list or out of the list. If your name is out of the list, you'll be given 30 days' time to convince them that you are actually an Indian. And if not, you'll be declared a foreigner, and you can be sent to detention camps. Or you have to negotiate the foreigner's trial. The question we are asking is, there is nothing in the government circular, there has been no debate in parliament about what is the criteria to keep me in the NPR and keep me out. As I explained to you, in Assam there was a context. Right or wrong, there was a context. But in the rest of India, when that officer comes to your house, on what ground is he going to keep Teesta out and keep Uday Kumar in? We have no idea. What is he going to ask for? What is the proof he's going to ask for? What are the documents he's going to ask for? There is no clarity from the government. There is no public debate on the issue. Therefore, we believe that the entire purpose is to generate fear and division among the people. Because a rumor mongering of the RSS has started saying this is against Muslims. And we are telling people it's not just against Muslims. It's a policy that wants to divide us in the name of religion. But once, God forbid, once it's implemented, it will impact every working citizen. And you'll be doing nothing else for the next 20 years except showing your documents. We have to resist it. We have to question it. And even Kerala needs to come out on the streets to mobilize, not just against CAB, but also against NPR and NRC. That's my appeal to you today, on the eve of International Human Rights Day. Please, educate yourself about it. Find out more about it. And you'll make sense of what I'm saying. In Assam, for 6 years, government offices did nothing but this. For 6 years, long queues out of villages. People had to go and simply run around clutching their documents. Kerala had a very bad flood 2 years ago. Assam has a flood every year, just like Bangladesh. Villages move during the floods. What happens to families who lose their documents? Natural and man-made disasters, during fires, during communal violence, where will they get those documents? It is an unbelievable humanitarian crisis that Assam is facing, and this government threatens to bring this all over India. It is going to be something of the kind we have not seen before. It strikes at the very core of our constitution. And therefore, I'm appealing to all of you. First time in Kerala, I'm making this appeal. I shall do it wherever I go, that please stand up against NPR and NRC and mobilize people against it before the government dares to bring it in. On 6th of September this year, the Bengal government passed a resolution against the NRC. It was drafted by the left, but TMC left and Congress passed it. Only the BJP members opposed it. I'm appealing to you in Kerala. Talk to the government here. And the CPM government must pass a resolution because UDF will support it. It must oppose NPR and NRC just like Bengal has done. If we don't do, this is a political battle. It's a civil society battle, it's a human rights battle, and it's a battle for the core of our constitution. I'd like to end by saying that the worst part of the politics of the Rashtriya Swayamsevak Sangh that rules the country is that it rules through intimidation and fear. This fear and intimidation has silenced many people. I believe it has also silenced good thinking people in Kerala. It's time to break that silence. If we don't speak up now, we will be overwhelmed by a crisis of humongous proportions. We know Golwalkar on this. We know what Golwalkar said about how India should learn from Hitler's Germany and the second-class citizens for Golwalkar and the RSS are Muslims, Christians, communists, because they are the internal enemies of the Indian nation, according to the RSS. They would like to bring in an entire construct which is based on the worst part of the Manusmriti. What happened in Hyderabad following the veterinarian's disgusting and scary rape, in my mind, is no worse than what happened in Unnao. But Unnao doesn't get that outrage, but Hyderabad does. Kanchipuram, Baroda, Maharashtra, Punjab, everywhere we are seeing gang rape of young women. There is no part of our society that has been spared. Why is this worst side of human nature, gendered violence against young girls and women, suddenly increased to this extent? I believe there is a connection to the fascist forces in power. Because when there's a culture of impunity, when the mob feels that it will not be pulled up, and when sections of the mob are allied to the ruling dispensation, you see crimes against every section of the marginalized population. We know a lot about Munje. We know a lot about Golwalkar. We know less about Munje. B.S. Munje was an RSS ideologue. He is notorious for setting up the Bhosla military academies. And there are many of them that run in independent India, where they train young people in the use of arms. Ex-army men train people in the use of arms. So this man, Munje, set up the Bhosla military academies after he returned from a 10-day meeting with Mussolini in Italy. But Munje did something else. He wrote a diary about his experiences there. And in that diary, he writes that there is nothing like the politics of fear and death. And he recounts how he was traveling in Bihar in Islampur during the partition violence. And Bihar, as we know, had targeted minority Muslims more. Just like in Punjab, you had the Sikhs targeted more, and in Bengal, you had the Hindus targeted more. And when he was in Islampur, an old man with a skull cap ran up to him, touched his feet and said, "Bhai sahab, marna kaatna chhod do, hum Hindu banke rahenge." That is the politics of the RSS. Riots, pogroms, genocidal violence, lynchings, now citizenship. It's all part of the same somehow beat society into shape. And the worst part of the citizenship onslaught is that it appeals to the devil inside you and me, because the rumor mongering tells us that it's against Muslims. So many sections of Hindus feel that if it's against Muslims, then why let it happen? So we need to tackle this demon within us, but we need to raise our voices against the NRC and NPR as much as the Saints can. Thank you very, very much. I've taken up too much time. Thank you very, very much for your patience. Thank you very much.